This first topic is the creation of Adam and Eve. And we could either do this where I could ask you questions for 5 minutes, or you could ask me questions for 5 minutes, or we can do one for 10 minutes. Is there something you would like to address the atheist, or I could ask you some questions? How do you want to do that?
Well, we can forget the clock if you'd like and just talk, but...
I'm trying to keep it to 10 minutes.
All right. Did you have parents and grandparents?
Yes.
Did they have parents and grandparents?
Yes.
Were they human?
Yes.
Okay. How far back do you go before they become non-human, would you guess?
Well, the first thing is there is no dividing line between human and non-human. So in other words, there is no point where a non-human gave birth to a human.
Okay. Are apes human then?
No, apes are not human.
Okay. Is an ape-like ancestor back there in your family tree someplace?
Sure. Yeah, yeah. Like Richard Dawkins says, if you go back 198 million generations, your ancestors are fish.
Well, his ancestors maybe, but not mine.
Yeah.
Okay. So you then do believe that you came from, let's say, a fish, ultimately, if you go back far enough.
Sure. Yeah. 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 I mean, all the way back to, you might say, a rock or whatever. There was a time where there was no life, and life arose. Yeah.
So life, in your religion, life did arise from non-living material.
Sure.
At some.
Yeah.
Is that something you can prove or something you believe? Would that be considered a religious doctrine or scientific fact?
Well, in between the scientific fact, I would say that's part of the theory, the scientific theory right now. It's basically the best, you know what inference to the best explanation is in a hypothesis is an inference to the best explanation. So basically you have competing ideas. I mean, one idea is that God created humans by magic, boom. The other one is that humans evolved naturally. And I think the better hypothesis is that everything happened naturally.
Yeah, I'd rather have you use the word hypothesis, because in my understanding of teaching science 15 years, a hypothesis is just a guess, and a theory has at least some evidence to support it. No one's ever seen non-living material come alive, and they can't even make it happen in the laboratory, so it really wouldn't qualify as a theory. It would be a hypothesis at best.
Okay, so your focus now is on the abiogenesis, the start of life. Yeah, so basically there are things we have no clue about how it actually happened. And the tricky thing there is, even if scientists could make life pop out from non-life, as a creationist you can still say, like, well, that's fine, you did that in the lab, but that doesn't prove nature could do that, right?
Well, there'd be several things that would prove if scientists make it. The fact that they haven't, I think, is pretty telling. But if they could produce life in the laboratory, that would prove it takes intelligence to make life. It wouldn't prove it could happen by itself, and it certainly wouldn't prove it did happen by itself. That wouldn't even be evidence for the theory.
No, I mean, it would take intelligence to set up that lab experiment, but there's no intelligence actually making the life. I mean, it could, you know, if there was a natural, like a spark in the right chemicals and the right atmosphere, if that could somehow do it, it would be purely natural. It's just that the intelligence made the scenario for it.
Well, then you'd have to argue for who made the spark and the atmosphere and the space and the time and the matter. And, you know, you're assuming an awful lot of things are already there for this to start. I mean, where did time come from? Where did matter come from? Where did space? Where did energy? Where's this spark coming?
Yeah,
I mean,
so basically,
you're an electronics engineer. Nothing happens. Nothing complex comes together by itself. And life is more complex than any computer man's ever built.
That's kind of interesting, because we have these different topics to talk about, and right now we're kind of going into a different one, like the, you know, why is there something rather than nothing? We're kind of going all over the map. Can I bring it back into Adam and Eve again?
Sure, it's your program. Go ahead.
Okay, let me ask you a question about this. You know, as far as I'm concerned, one reason, there are two main reasons why I accepted evolution for humans as descended from other animals. One is the pseudogene argument, and the other one is fused human chromosome number 2. Are you familiar with both of those?
I am.
So why is not fused human chromosome number 2? Why is that not compelling to you?
Any chromosome is more complicated than the space shuttle. You're an electronics engineer. For heaven's sake, you know, complicated things do not just happen. How many things could go wrong in a computer to make it stop working? How many simple things?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with you. It's mind-boggling. It's complex.
Okay, well, if someone wants to believe it happened by chance over billions of years with no directing process, they can certainly believe that, but that's not science. Nobody's observed that.
But it's kind of like if you saw footsteps outside or a crime scene situation, you may not know how it happened, but the fact that there's footprints there show that it did happen, and that's what the fused human chromosome is that there's vestigial telomeres and a vestigial centromere. That seems like that makes no sense. If God made humans from scratch, he wouldn't. Why would he put in vestigial DNA?
Well, first, I don't think we know all the uses of the DNA, and it could be something that's simply broken. I had a car once that had an air conditioner that didn't work, but the designer designed it with one, and it worked when it came off the assembly line, but it quit working somewhere along the line. So the fact, if humans have DNA telomeres or whatever that no longer work, that's not evidence for evolution. That's evidence that we're a degraded 40,000th generation from Adam.
Well, the way it works is that chromosomes have telomeres on the end, and these two chromosomes attached. So in the middle now, you have two telomeres where you don't need a telomere, and because you don't need them, now they're vestigial. And then each chromosome also has one centromere. It needs one center, and since it joined, it now has two centers. So the other one is totally not needed as a centromere anymore, so it's vestigial. So why would God create that from scratch?
I don't know. I don't know that he did. Maybe Adam and Eve didn't have it, and maybe it is something that happened somewhere along the line. Maybe just like, you know, my car air conditioning quit working. Okay, well, it was working when they sold it to me. It quit working later. So, you know, we are X number of generations from Adam. So to say, hey, this is now broken, therefore there was no original Adam, that's a silly argument.
Well, it's not that it's broken. It's just that, like I said, the telomeres are on the ends. And now when they join head to head, you don't need them in the middle anymore. And that's why they're not used. I mean, what is that code? It's obviously a telomere. There's no reason for and the reason why we know these two genes or these two chromosomes came together is because we can see the same like genes on the chimp, who is our cousin. We can see the genes there, so they all perfectly line up.
Why do you think the chimps are our cousins? Because they have similar genes? Does that make them?
Well, this is one of the examples of why we think they're cousins, is because of the way the DNA lines up.
Are there any lines of code from Microsoft Word that are used exactly in Microsoft PowerPoint? I mean, how many lines mm-hmm. of code are identical?
It's possible.
I think there are probably many thousands of lines of code. Why would they rewrite the whole code for every new program? Any programmer is going to reuse as many lines of code as he can that have already been written.
So yeah, I mean, I work at a high technology company, and we make these advanced computer chips, and it's, you know, we try to reuse a lot of stuff, but it is amazing how, because we make such great advances, we do have to like write, there is a lot of new stuff going into each one, but there is also a lot of carryover. Yeah. I'm not sure what the point is, because the carryover seems to prove evolution.
The carryover in the stuff that you do happens by intelligent choice. You choose to carry over X number of lines of code into the new program to save time or mm-hmm. whatever. It would be logical for the creator to use similar lines of code in the DNA and similar chromosome structure and similar lots of things. For one thing, we couldn't eat other animals if they weren't, we couldn't digest them and use anything out of them. You know, the fact that the brown cow can eat the green grass and make the white milk, and I can drink it and get the blonde hair, that's pretty amazing. That's intelligent design at its best. God's thinking ahead. Let's make these out of similar material so they're digestible. I guess I don't comprehend at all how that proves evolution.
The thing I'm trying to understand is with this, if God, like I said, I work at a company, we make these advanced chips. We do not build in chips with junk and old baggage and all that kind of stuff. And obviously, it's obvious that there's a fused chromosome in humans. I mean, Are you denying that it's a fused chromosome?
I don't know. I know that 100 years ago, there were 180 vestigial organs on the list, things we don't need anymore. Mm-hmm. They've now reduced that list to zero. Could it be that we simply don't know the function of it yet, or that it serves as a space holder for something else? If it is a broken gene, which it may indeed be, or a broken section of a chromosome, how does a broken air conditioner on a car prove nobody made it?
Yeah, the broken gene argument is actually a little different. That's the pseudogene argument. This is more of seeing how it's assembled. Basically, like you say, if you have a car, if somebody says, hey, Ken, let me show you my cool hot rod I bought, and you look at it and you can say, like, oh, wow, I can see the chassis is from a Chevy and I can see the bed is from a Ford. That's kind of what's going on here, is we can see how things were plastered together. It's like, well, what's this other piece on here? Well, that was just leftover. The Ford had it, but we don't use it, so it's just hanging around. But if it was created from scratch, you wouldn't, that doesn't make sense if there's an intelligent designer.
Okay, so your argument would be, because we do not currently understand chromosome number 2, the use of some things, and we are assuming that it is indeed useless information or, you know, useless baggage, therefore, there is no designer. Does that summarize your argument fairly?
No, what I'm trying to say is we know what a telomere is. They're the end codes on a chromosome. And when these two chromosomes got together, they fused in the center. And therefore, those telomeres are not used. And because they're not used, now they're just vestigial. So we know what they were. They had an actual function. You can tell what they were. And now they're totally not needed, of course. And so it's all degraded. I mean, so we know where it was used before, and it's not using that function anymore. So it's obvious it's a fusion event. And if it's a fusion event, you're just trying to figure out, why is God cobbling things together instead of just doing things? If he made humans from scratch like you're proposing, it seems like it would have been a clean design instead of smacking chromosomes together. It's kind of weird.
When was this chromosome fusion discovered? When did they discover that this chromosome 2 has these telomeres?
Well, I heard it was around the year 2000 when they got the actual code, because, you know, they started decoding the genome. But I actually had a printout from like 1985 where they were showing a lot of the genes, and they can see there was a fusion event there. But I think it was like since the year 2000, they got the actual code. They know the actual fusion event, the actual DNA coding at that section there.
Okay, could the fusion event have occurred then in 1984?
No, it's because, I mean, all humans have it.
Okay, so could it have occurred in 1824? Or could it have occurred 2,000 years ago in time for all humans to get it?
Well, this is actually like the Denisovan, the Neanderthal, and the humans all have this fused human chromosome, and like the orangutan, the chimp, doesn't.
How do you know the Neanderthals have it? Do they find that in the bones?
They got it from the DNA. I'm not sure where they got the DNA from.
Yeah, I'd be curious about that.
Yeah, the Denisovan, I think they got from a thumb or something. They got all the DNA code.
If fused chromosome number 2, which has a useless section where the telomeres join, I'm assuming equidistant from the centromes, and this is...
No,
this
it's not really equal. It's not really equidistant. It's just on the ends.
Okay. And this is evidence that we all came from a rock.
No, it's evidence that there was a... It's evidence of descent from other animals instead of being designed from scratch intelligently, like boom, here's a brand new design. I mean, according to your theory, there were no humans, and all of a sudden, boom, God made humans. So it's like, you know, if they're made from scratch, he didn't have to worry about cobbling things together from other creatures.
Okay, and you're saying orangutans and chimpanzees do not have this fused chromosome?
Right.
But yet they are related to us.
Right. Yeah, because
I don't understand.
Because we can see the chromosomes they have, and we can see how those got smudged together to create our number 2. Our number 2 is like their 2A and 2B or so. If you put two of theirs together, you can see how ours is.
Yeah. And so if I
and because it got smudged together, it's got the vestigial telomeres and centromere in there, because there's no point for those.
Okay, my argument would be very simple. We don't know when this happened. It was just discovered in the last 25 or 30 years. We don't know when it happened. The fact that some animals don't have it, we don't know that it's useless. I think it'd be fair to say we currently don't know the use of it, but it may be indeed. I'm not saying it's not useless. It may indeed be. But then again, could be something broken, like the air conditioner on the car that quit working after, 20 years after the car was built. That's an example of degradation, not evolution. I don't see how you can possibly see that as evidence for evolution. I'm really lost here.
Okay. Can we leave it there and go on to the next topic, since we're running a little over time? Okay. I know it's a little bit frustrating because we can't really dig down in anything, but it's just kind of interesting also getting a overview, I guess, on some of these.